you have worked with an individual or individuals that have that engage in PICA? So quite a few of you. We'll talk a little bit about the prevalence. It's not as prevalent as some other problem behaviors, particularly among individuals with developmental disabilities, but it's clear that it happens quite a bit. And the severity of the PICA can also range. When we talk today, I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview of PICA, talk about some medical assessment that's mostly outside of my area, so I'll just give you a brief overview of my experience with collaborating with medical professionals around assessment and treatment of PICA, and then we'll talk about behavioral assessment of PICA. And then I will talk a little bit about some different treatment types that are useful for addressing PICA, and some of them are antecedent-based and some of them are consequence-based. So as many of you know, PICA is a persistent, as Pat mentioned, she defined it very well, it's just eating things that have no nutritional value and are not normally things that people might ingest. And it is considered a form of self-injurious behavior, particularly when it is not happening within the context of typical development. And so PICA comes from the Latin word magpie, and magpies, as some of you may know, will eat anything. They'll eat garbage, they will eat, it doesn't matter what it is, and so I think that's the reason why there is that relationship between the bird magpie and the word PICA. PICA and mouthing are not the same thing, so some of you might work with clients that engage in persistent mouthing, and that might actually produce some skin degradation on their hands or possibly on their mouth, and it's certainly a form of self-injurious behavior, but they're not, it's not actually passing the plane of their mouth and they're not swallowing that item, so that would be kind of a distinction. I am going to show you just a brief video. I think you know, certainly we can appreciate that that PICA is very dangerous, and I think it's important to understand kind of the family perspective and what it's like to care for a child that engages in PICA, because it is such a life-threatening behavior.
Now that we've been dealing with it for 5 years.
With two active kids, Michelle Backus has her hands full for sure, especially with her autistic son Benji, who has a secret the family tried to hide. It's a puzzle that researchers are trying to solve.
When did you think it was weird of what he was eating?
I have to say probably around 2.5 or so.
Benji also has PICA. It's a disorder that gives him an appetite for items not found in the pantry.
Things that aren't food.
Things that aren't food, yeah.
Like what?
Grass and dirt. He'll swallow small pebbles. He chews on sticks. He'll eat crayons and Play-Doh and glue and our toothpaste and our shampoo and our dish soap.
Reality shows like My Strange Addiction sparked a lot of curiosity about those who will eat anything from glass to even pillow cushions. But for doctors, little is known about PICA or what causes it.
So it could be common in any children, but frequently there are populations that are more at risk for it.
Dr. Philip Basie is an assistant professor of psychiatry at the University of Utah. He says PICA will often surface out of nowhere, and you may not believe some of the things people with PICA will eat.
Hair, burnt matches. Cigarette butts is another common one.
There are theories on what may cause PICA. Mineral deficiencies and mental illness are two possibilities. For Benji's mom, though, his compulsive eating is one more thing that keeps her up at night.
He's never really had two colonoscopies and two endoscopies.
Medical problems aside, Michelle says PICA affects what the family does in public. She says it's hard not to notice a kid eating dirt at a park. And with critical looks and questions thrown her way, it's hard to hide her embarrassment.
I tend to feel embarrassed in a way, like, because then they're all staring at him thinking, why is he doing that? I've had people actually ask to be moved in a restaurant, so you know that they're moving because of you.
While the looks affect Michelle, Benji appears happy in his own little world, even as he lives with two medical disorders not fully understood.
You just, I think, have to learn that you have to accept the child for what he's gonna be. And, you know, as long as he's happy and, he's thriving, you just, be happy for him.
For now, they lock up any dangerous temptations for Benji and hope the disorder will lessen with time. Mary Nichols, 2 News.
Again, it's important to understand the family context here when we're providing intervention for kids who eat things that are potentially life-threatening. You'll notice when they started flashing up all of those items that the kid eats, did any of you notice something about them? They're all over the home. They're everywhere. It's dish soap, toothpaste. I mean, these are very common items that are quite difficult to lock up. So there is this kind of constant attending to the environment and wondering what's going to be the next thing that they ingest. And so that is very difficult to maintain over time, is that level of awareness and hypervigilance with keeping the environment clean. It's something that's necessary, but they need some additional resources to help them, because that's something that's very difficult to maintain, is just prevention. One thing that you'll notice is that, do any of you recognize what's happening with his, what's going on with his shirt? What's hanging off of it? Like a chew pee. And this is something that people might use when there's this assumption that competing items, and we'll talk about that later, can be a good thing. But you'll notice that this item is certainly not competing with PICA. He's got that item that's immediately available within arm's reach, and he is just fully going at eating several crayons at a time. So I'm going to talk a little bit about when we're implementing interventions, we need to be really careful about evaluating the effects. This is something that is not clearly effective and doesn't compete consistently with PICA, and it's something that's probably that they could probably spend their time arranging other interventions rather than the chew piece. So I just kind of wanted to bring your attention to that, because it's something that's very common that people often recommend, and it's something that is not usually effective. PICA is common among children with very young children. So how many of you have had young children in the last like year or two or three? Okay, have any of you, have any of your kids eaten stuff that they shouldn't be eating? Like what?
Poop.
What?
Poop.
Poop, yep, that's a common one.
In the bathtub,
and
grab it really quickly.
It's like, no! Yeah, so this is something really common, but usually kids will stop engaging in those behaviors, usually because we're gonna let them know that that's not something that they need to be doing, and usually that drops out over time. So it's, if you see that with really young, typically developing kids, it's often not something of concern, so long as they're not too old. But when they with individuals with developmental disabilities, I might be a little bit less inclined to wait it out and see if they kind of grow out of it. I think, unfortunately, that is sometimes the advice that's provided by medical providers in terms of feeding interventions and maybe even PICA. And those PICA can be life-threatening, and so it's kind of important to balance out waiting versus implementing an intervention right away. So many of you have already identified these, and they brought up some of these in the video, but these are probably some of the main culprits for PICA items. You'll notice that these things are everyday items that are part of most people's environments on a daily basis. Usually I find that there sometimes are kids that when they engage in PICA, there's kind of a theme. So I worked with a client who often ate metallic items, and that was kind of, the PICA was limited to those items. But this child, for example, in the video, engaged in a wide range of items of different textures. Grass and crayons have quite different textures. So, but these are some of the main culprits. And then there, as you can imagine, there's all kinds of medical and nutritional risks with PICA. If they're eating substances that are not nutritious, this is certainly not a good thing. Intestinal blockage can happen. I'll show you a couple of images before. But depending on the PICA item, it could be quite dangerous. So I've worked with kids who want to go after paper clips and thumbtacks and bleach. These are all items that can be life-threatening or can result in death. So out of all of the self-injurious behaviors, all the different topographies, PICA is certainly the most life-threatening, and that's why it's really important to identify it and address it. Now, some of you have worked with clients where they might eat grass every once in a while, And that may be less severe, but you might also work with clients who are going after household cleaners and other items that can be potentially life-threatening. So the severity of the items that they're eating need to be balanced in when you're doing treatment development and planning your assessments and things. These are some summary data that are presented in the Hanley, Iwata, and McCord 2003 paper, where they reviewed a bunch of different cases and looked at the results of functional analyses. And so you'll see that PICA is actually a pretty infrequently occurring topography of behavior, at least in terms of the functional analysis literature. Since then, there have been additional studies that have been conducted, so certainly I'm unsure if that would produce any differences in the prevalence, but I think it was smart of them to take out PICA from self-injurious behavior just to kind of tweeze out the two. This is an x-ray of a client that attended a facility that I used to work at, and he was referred for severe PICA that involved eating metal objects. And do any of you notice anything?
Safety pin.
Yeah, there's a safety pin sticking in his throat. So that he ate that, and it got stuck and lodged in his throat. He would often eat items, and he would also put items in other areas. So I actually spent about 5 or 6 hours at an emergency room with him one time because he got a bean caught up his nose. But he also had escape maintain behavior to get away from medical procedures. And so we had to basically do some treatment immediately. So he had a lot of experience with going to the emergency room because of this kind of behavior. Actually, there it is. And then here is another one that I got off of the internet. This person ingested a couple of pounds worth of coins. And so as you can imagine, this is extremely dangerous and requires surgery. We're not going to probably wait until that passes, which may be reasonable for something like crayons, but not reasonable for something like coins. This can wreak havoc on your GI tract and is something that's serious. So again, the seriousness of PICA is often related to the types of items that they're ingesting and how often they're exploring new PICA items. Sometimes they kind of have their, you know, they're just about the grass or they're just about the dirt. But if there's kind of a few items that they're going after and they're trying new items, that is something that would warrant an even more kind of intensive intervention. So that's a brief overview of PICA. And now I'm going to talk a little bit about medical assessment and then get mostly into the behavioral assessment of PICA. For any of the clients that you're working with, if they're engaging in PICA, you should request that they get some kind of medical assessment to rule out any medical causes for PICA. So doctors are going to look at things like nutritional deficiencies. They might look for other medical causes of PICA that might be relevant. And they will also be really great at assisting with the assessment and treatment of PICA and some of the medical issues kind of that you need to touch base with them about, and I'll get into that in just briefly. One thing I also want to mention is that the reason why you want to do the medical assessment is because we can implement behavioral interventions to address PICA, but if there's an underlying medical cause, the treatment will be ineffective. And as behavior analysts, we need to rule out or rule in medical causes of behavior and have those addressed as a baseline before we start intervening behaviorally. Another way that medical assessment can be useful is that they can kind of provide some monitoring. So sometimes it's unclear if an individual actually engaged in PICA. There might be some missing items and people are unsure. Maybe the client is, you know, grabbing at their stomach or engaging in indices of pain. And in that situation, you are probably going to want to bring them to the ER and get some kind of x-ray done or some kind of manual physical exam so that that can be checked out. Also, they can help with doing stool checks. They can tell you how to perform stool checks, and then also how to respond to irregularities in the stool. So if you're doing an assessment and usually they're either constipated or it's quite solid, and then you're doing an assessment or they engage in PICA and then you notice diarrhea, that's probably going to warrant some kind of plan, and they can assist with identifying those things that are really important and then figuring out how to best respond to them so that they can be safe. And then also the doctor might be good at helping us to identify behaviors that are correlated with pain. I think people in behavior analysis also do that type of work, but doctors also have that knowledge, and I've probably heard many people report about the way that their child indicates that they're in pain. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about the behavioral assessment of PICA. In most situations, PICA is maintained by automatic reinforcement. Now, we can't really directly assess automatic reinforcement as a function. Automatic reinforcement can kind of come in two forms. One, it can be something about, it can come in the form of automatic positive reinforcement. So for example, if somebody is eating a sponge, the stimuli and the sensation produced from, like, their tongue hitting the sponge may be reinforcing. So there's something added to the environment, something added to their mouth or the stimulation that is reinforcing the behavior. That's probably what's happening with PICA if it is maintained by automatic reinforcement. There is another class of automatic reinforcement called automatic negative reinforcement. So an example might be if you are engaging, if you're working with somebody with self-injurious behavior, they may actually have a chronic ear infection. And they've learned in the past that hitting their ear produces endorphins. They're not saying that, oh, when I hit my ear, it produces endorphins. But what they've learned is that when I hit my ear, the pain is relieved temporarily. The chronic hitting of the ear is also an issue because it probably exacerbates the medical condition. That's another good example of why you need to do a medical evaluation before treating the behavior, because in that case, treat the infection. And then also, you're probably going to need to also follow up with a behavioral intervention to address the behavioral aspects of it. So even though PICA is maintained in most cases by automatic reinforcement, we shouldn't assume that it's always maintained by automatic reinforcement. And I'm going to show you and talk to you a little bit about a case that was published where the behavior was maintained by attention. And so, just like any behavior that we see, there's the possibility is that it's maintained by a variety of consequences, or just because one person engages in PICA and has and there's an automatic function doesn't necessarily mean that another person with PICA, their behavior is also maintained by automatic reinforcement. Most often it is, but not always. So we need to keep that critical lens and not just go in and be like, oh, it's automatic, we're just gonna go in there and do competing items and then everything's gonna be great. Again, it's a life-threatening behavior potentially, and so we wanna make sure that when we do the assessment, we know for sure that we're intervening at the right level. So if it does have an attention component and we don't address that, the behavior will linger and it will continue to be a problem, and we want to avoid that. So I recommend that people use functional analysis methodology to assess PICA, and this actually, because it's most often maintained by automatic reinforcement, I find that assessing PICA using a functional analysis is very straightforward and can usually be conducted within the context of an hour, maybe two at most. So when you're doing an assessment, the first thing to do is get some reports from caregivers, from people who spend a lot of time with the client, so that we can find out some information about the behavior. So we want to know things like, when is it most likely to happen? When is it least likely to happen? So you might find it's never happens during meal times. It seems obvious, I know, but that's important to know nonetheless. Or, you know, when I'm playing with them one-on-one and giving them attention, or when they're playing with their little brother, they hardly ever engage in PICA. That's good to know too, because what that means is maybe attention and interaction and engaging with activities could potentially compete with PICA. And so that could be something that is part of the treatment plan, or at least, at the very least, a Band-Aid. So, you know, in the assessment process, people usually want to get right to treatment. And so if we know that if you pay attention to them and you're engaging with them with activities, that might be something to do temporarily until a treatment can get put into place that's more sustainable. We also want to find out things that are commonly ingested and exactly what it looks like, if we can get examples of it, if there are particular things. So they don't like the big paper clips, they only go after the little paper clips. That's important to know. So getting as much information that you can about the PICA items. And then also responses to blocking PICA. So undoubtedly, the caregiver or a teacher or somebody that spends a lot of time with that kid, if they're engaging in PICA, their PICA has been blocked at some point. Almost always. So we want to know, what's the reaction? Does it produce problem behavior and more intense and forceful forms of PICA to try to get it in? Or is it something where they can be redirected easily to another item and it's not, and they aren't persistent at going back at the PICA item? So that's important to know, just for the purposes of treatment development and kind of figuring out if blocking is a component, is that going to be an easy road, or is that going to be a more challenging road where there's going to be some additional things that need to happen so that blocking the PICA doesn't produce problem behavior? And it's very likely when you block things like, have any of you ever blocked stereotypy and problem behavior happens? Mm-hmm. Yeah, usually it's to get access to uninterrupted stereotypy time. Similarly, it's very common when you're working with individuals who engage in PICA that they have learned from a history, I go to engage in PICA, somebody blocks it, I hit them, they back off, and now I have free access to the PICA item. We don't mean to teach that, but sometimes individuals will learn that, because a natural response to somebody hitting you is to back off a little bit, especially with people who aren't trained as behavior analysts. Some behavior analysts would probably not respond that way, but it's a very common response. So we want to watch out for that, because that's something that will impact decisions regarding treatment. And then also how often it happens. And in addition to how often it happens, is it a durational thing, like one of the kids was kind of just chomping on crayons? Is that something that they are just engaging in for a period of time, but only maybe eating two or three? Or is it, if you give them a box of 64, if you don't watch out, that's going to be gone in 30 minutes? That's kind of important to know. Also, what I would add to this is finding out information about the medical history, getting access to the medical records. This should happen as part of the medical assessment, but it is important to keep all of that in mind, and also any protocols that they have in place for safety, how they respond already to instances of PICA. So if they're going to the emergency room for certain forms of PICA, when you're working on that case, it's important to follow through with that, because that's a medical recommendation. For the functional analysis, there's kind of two routes. One of them, I think, is more preferable than the other because it yields more information. One of them is a pairwise comparison. So let's say that the hypothesis is it's maintained by automatic reinforcement. You might set up a situation where they're in a alone condition, or an ignore, where nobody's really paying attention to them, but somebody's present. And you're gonna kind of look at instances of PICA. I'll talk a little bit about what that looks like in a minute. And you're gonna contrast that with maybe another condition where you give them access to items, you're interacting with them and engaging in toy play. And then you would look at the difference between the levels of PICA when you're kind of letting them, you're not providing like a lot of things going on in the environment, it's kind of barren, there's no interaction, versus engaging in play and giving them activities to engage in. I'll show you some data in a minute to show you some pairwise comparisons. Another thing that you can do, let's say you want to test for attention and automatic reinforcement. You might do a pairwise with the attention, where you're providing attention contingent on PICA, and then you are providing them with non-contingent attention the whole time during the toy play condition. And then what you might do is then do another phase where you do an extended ignore condition or an extended alone condition, where you're just looking at when left to their own devices, in kind of a controlled situation, are they going to continue to engage in PICA when we're not paying attention to it? Is it going to persist in the absence of social consequences? And again, I'll show you some examples of what that looks like on a graph, because I think that'll be a good way to describe it. But those are kind of the two ways that sometimes people will get at doing an analysis and figuring out why people are engaging in PICA. But typically, in the past, it's been maintained by automatic reinforcement and or attention. Yeah, I'll show you the one with attention because it's a really interesting case. Just as a brief review, I'm going to do a little bit on functional analysis and then do a little bit of a myth-busting exercise, although all of you are so savvy that I anticipate this will just be something that you already know, and that's quite easy. But to kind of give you an idea of this functional analysis, it's really just, it was something that was developed as a research protocol by Brian Iwata and his colleagues at University of Florida. And it was really just a research protocol to start working to identify the function to do more research on assessment and then additional research on treatment. But really it just involves altering what happens before the behavior and changing what happens after the behavior in a structured, systematic way to look at when behavior is most likely and when behavior is less likely. The nice thing about the functional analysis that I really like is not only does it give you definitively what the function of behavior is, it might also tell you when is behavior less likely. So if I do attention versus control and I find out, oh, it's really high in attention and it's really low in the control condition, the conclusion is it's in part at least maintained by attention. But I also think there's an additional piece of information that is important and that's sometimes overlooked. We also know that in a toy play condition, PICA is less likely to happen. And that's really good to know. It might not be sustainable. We can't do a toy play condition in life 24 hours a day. I would love that. That would be amazing, but that's just not life, and we can't do that. But it is reasonable to do it sometimes, and it may be reasonable, again, as a Band-Aid until a more nuanced and thoughtful treatment plan can be organized. Is there a standard functional analysis that's used for clinical purposes?
False.
Why? It's forced choice. You got by chance you could have gotten it right. So why?
Well, because it depends on the individual client.
Thank you.
We make no.
Yes, that is a very simple and concise reason. Is because if tangibles or escape isn't indicated at all by caregivers, we're not going to spend our time assessing escape and tangible. We're only going to assess those things that seem to be meaningful from the perspective of the caregivers and the teachers and how people are responding to that behavior. So like this happened, I saw this happen one time in my practice, not in my practice, but I saw somebody else do it. And I had really good supervisors at the time that they said, yeah, you know, you don't do that. So if I have an individual with aggressive behavior, and I start giving them Cheetos every time they hit me, what do you think is going to happen if they like Cheetos?
He's going to kill you.
Yeah, they're going to hit me a whole lot. But never was there a time when the parent or a teacher said, you know what, I really give them Cheetos every time they hit me. People, now that candy bar example in the grocery store, sometimes it happens, sometimes they might get a donut before they actually finish the loop around the grocery store. But usually people don't give food items for those kinds of behaviors. So we only want to assess conditions that seem to make sense for that particular individual. And that will also save you a lot of time. So in the Iwata protocol, they looked at alone or no interaction, attention, escape, tangible wasn't invented yet, if you will, and then a control condition. So we may not even be assessing any of these things. The control condition that is in the protocol by Iwata is not the control condition that I would recommend that you do all of the time. There's ways that you actually design the those conditions. If you want to know more about designing functional analysis conditions, I know that Pat is going to put up the video that I did a while back for the BCBA-D Student Alliance, and they're also going to have it on their website for members. And so if you want to know more information about how to design the conditions, how to design those conditions and some considerations, you can check that out. Okay. Functional analysis should always include a control condition. What do you think? Yes, true. We need it. We need it to show differentiated responding. So what we want is to show we have control over the situations when they engage and don't engage in PICA. So we see in this condition, we see high levels of behavior, and in this condition, we see low levels of behavior. And this is how we interpret the graph, and I'll show you some of those examples of undifferentiated, where they ended up having to do additional analysis, and then differentiated ones where we can develop clear conclusions about the results. So One thing to mention with the control condition is that it'll look different depending on the client that you're working with. So if you're assessing attention, and that's all that seems to be going on, there's no indication that tangibles are a thing, then assessing attention is very straightforward. In the attention condition, you ignore them, and then when they engage in the behavior, you pay attention to it. And you pay attention to it in the same way that other people pay attention to it in their natural environment. In the control condition, you're just going to pay attention to them the whole time. There's no need to put toys in there, and in fact, you don't want to put toys in there because you're not assessing tangibles. So we just want to look at what happens when we provide attention based on problem behavior versus what happens when we provide attention for free, if you will. And what we would expect if behavior is maintained by attention is we're going to get a whole lot in the attention condition, and we're not going to get any in the control condition. So the goal is for the control condition to result in low levels of behavior. I will show you some examples where that's not what happened, and then that means that we don't have control over the reinforcer in that situation. True or false? We should avoid functional analysis in really severe cases. So you've got a really severe instance of PICA. Should we avoid doing a functional assessment?
False.
Yes, I think it's false. And so here's the notion, and I think this is really important, is that it is very reasonable for people to have concerns about assessment and treatment. This is something that is important. And so the notion of we need to keep an individual safe, and why would we reinforce problem behavior, that doesn't make sense. So one analogy that was given to me that Hanley discusses in 2012, he talks about dispelling myths about functional analysis. Have any of you been to an allergist? Let's pretend I went to an allergist, and I'm wondering, you know, am I allergic to all of these things? Well, what do they do when you go to an allergist, what do? Yeah, they look for a reaction. So they establish different conditions wherever they do it, and then they look at when it turns behavior on, when an allergic reaction happens, and when an allergic reaction doesn't happen. And so I kind of think about a functional analysis as a bit of an allergy test. We want to know what is making behavior a lot worse, and what are some things that are making behavior better. The other reason why I think sometimes giving that analogy makes sense to people, because sometimes in a controlled situation that's safe and that's highly supervised, we need to look at what turns on and off behavior. And that's the same thing that a doctor or an allergist does when they do tests. So another reason why, some of the concern is, well, we don't want to reinforce problem behavior that might make it worse. So for those of you that are behavior analysts, you know that when there are two things that happen. One, when we continuously reinforce problem behavior, it actually results in a weakening of the behavior to a stable level. So when I first start working with an individual that engages in aggressive behavior and I'm doing a functional analysis, the first session it might be kind of on the more severe end. There might be some hitting. But by the end of the functional analysis, it's... And sometimes I've actually had to shape up aggressive behavior because it's gotten to the point where it's now a tap. It's like the least amount of effort required to produce the response during the functional analysis. So actually what you see over time, and there are data to support this, is that there is a general weakening of the behavior to a stable level, and it actually looks a lot safer. So one of the things that I recommend with treatment is before you start the intervention, reinforce problem behavior every single time it happens. Because then when we go to treatment, what happens when we go to treatment from intermittent reinforcement? Are we more likely to get an extinction burst? Yeah. What happens if we go to extinction from FR1 or continuous schedules? What happens? We might see an extinction burst, but it's less likely. And so by reinforcing problem behavior during a functional analysis and right before treatment, you're actually reducing the likelihood that unsafe behavior will happen. And there are data to support this, and they do discuss it in the Hanley paper. And Ophelia just did a study, a basic study, that supports that notion that not only do we see a decrease in the behavior, but we see a decrease in the force. Like I mentioned, it might go from really intense, forceful forms of hitting to something that would look more like getting somebody's attention, like tapping. Okay, so now I'm going to show you some examples of assessment and treatment of PICA. One of the things that I kind of ran into, and it's not a big issue, is that a lot of the studies on PICA involve assessment, but the assessment really kind of leads to the intervention. So they're kind of one and of the same. I'll talk a little bit about a few studies around assessment, but really they kind of lead into intervention, so I'm going to blend the two. So I remember reading this for the first time in graduate school, and it's probably one of my favorite studies. One, because it's a really interesting conceptual study, but also there are some lively details that are presented in the study that are quite interesting. And I'm actually jumping ahead of myself because this one is about actually treatment of cigarette butt PICA. But I'm going to talk to you about a case. The next case I'm going to tell you is the interesting one. But for this one, this individual engaged in cigarette butt PICA. And when you read the study, they do a really good job of explaining the context. So the family, they both worked full time. They were chronic smokers, and they used to sit outside of their porch and smoke cigarettes, the family. And then they would just, they didn't have like an ashtray that they'd put them in and then dispose of them every day or anything like that. So there were kind of cigarette butts that were all around the property. And so this individual, engaged in some PICA, and that developed, and it was really only about the cigarette butts. They didn't engage in other forms of PICA. And so what they did is, what I think is really interesting, they did a component analysis, and I think this is important. So what they wanted to do was separate out the effects of ingesting the paper and the filter versus the actual tobacco. So is this basically like a kid that is, or an adult, this is an adult, that essentially learned to smoke? They're not smoking, but they're ingesting cigarette butts, and that is, and what's maintaining it is the physiological effect of the tobacco. Or is it something about the properties of the cigarette in terms of like what it feels like in the mouth? And that's kind of important to know because it'll lead you down maybe some different roads. So what they did is they looked at two different cigarettes. They basically had sessions where they had cigarettes with tobacco in it and cigarettes with an herbal substitute. I'm not unsure exactly what they used, but it wasn't what we would normally associate with the word herbal. It was not that. And what you see is some differentiation where you get more allocating of their responding to the cigarette butt stuffed with PICA, or sorry, cigarette butt stuffed with tobacco versus the one that was stuffed with a herbal supplement. So it might actually have something to do with the tobacco. And then they did a component analysis where they looked at just giving them the paper versus the herbal stuffed butts, just the actual herb, the tobacco butts, and then just the tobacco. You can see that they are allocating most of their responding to the tobacco. I suspect that this, when they engaged in like eating the herbs, that they probably, that was maybe like the first trial or two, and then it quickly switched over to almost tobacco only. So this was kind of an interesting assessment because they wanted to know, is it the cigarette butt or is it the tobacco? Because if it's the tobacco, then maybe using a patch and then working on the behavioral aspect of it to substitute and then weaning off the patch, there's probably some other things to do. But if it's just the butt or something like that, or the filter, you know, the patch is unnecessary. We don't want to start creating another thing that you're going to need to fade out and get rid of. But it does lead down slightly different treatment paths. Let's talk about the safety and ethical considerations, because PICA is kind of a big one. When you're doing the assessment and treatment, it needs to be really done in a highly supervised, controlled fashion where you're collaborating with people that know something about PICA. So after you've gotten some information from families, you understand more about the context in which PICA is and is not occurring, then you should consult back with medical professionals about assessing PICA. Yeah.
So which medical professionals? Because there are times when I've sent the family in with the child to the pediatrician, they rule out that there is nothing that they can test for, blood tests are done, mm-hmm. and then we're sent on our way. right? So is it that we need to push for gastroenterology, or is there somebody in particular we can push the family towards to consult with? Because that's been a struggle that we've had, is having anybody who knows anything about it to do the medical side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think in this system, probably getting a referral to a GI would be a good, smart move, particularly depending on the pica substance, especially if it's probably doing some damage. Yeah. There's a difference between eating wax versus eating rocks and sand and clothing items that can wrap up and things like that. So I definitely think that's a good idea. One thing I was thinking about with this is, and questions to ask is, how much ingestion is allowed? So with bleach, the answer is none.
Yes.
And that's obvious, right? And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about when it's never possible and what to do about that. There's tons of options. But you do want to know. So let's say it's grass. You can come up with substitutable items, but it might be reasonable to let them have some grass because they're already eating it. It might be reasonable to let them have access to that, or maybe a little bit of dirt. Rocks, no, that's not reasonable, and those are dangerous items. So what you want to do is collaborate with a medical professional to find out which items are okay and not okay. Some of that we can figure out on our own, but I think we should make assumptions and we should consult. Another thing that I'll talk about are some bait items or items that we might use that resemble the pica item but that are not it. One example is dried beans. So you can't just let somebody eat dried beans all day long. There's a limit to how much, that's not really digestible. It's something that you need to consult with. So there might be some items that you're using that are acceptable to ingest in minimal amounts and might be included in the assessment, but something where you want to know. So for example, when we did assessments, I don't remember what the number was, but they told us like a certain number of dried kidney beans that we could have. Let's say it was 20. So when we baited the room with the pica items, we put down 20 beans and there were no other beans available. So we knew that when the beans were gone, the assessment was done, and we knew exactly how many they ate. We didn't just, you know, spill out a bag of beans and like try to stop them when they engage in the 20th pica response. So you can do it in a very controlled fashion. So really consulting about them about what items and how much, depending on whether or not you need to use the item or if you can come up with something that's substitutable. And that's actually really fun, and we'll talk about that. It's almost like arts and crafts day to make pica items. It's actually quite fun. Some other things that you want to talk to medical professionals about is how often stool checks should be conducted. Usually when you're doing the assessment and treatment, it's going to be always, and they've probably already put that into their kind of family routine, is maybe asking the individual if they pooped, or like telling them not to flush the toilet so that they can look at the poop and things like that. But also how to respond if the stool is irregular or if any kinds of issues arise. So one of the things you need to watch out for is indices of pain, grasping their belly, doing things like that they have learned to let people know that they are in pain. And that's something that you should watch out for, and then ask doctors what's the best way to respond. Usually it's to bring them to the ER so that they can get some kind of physical exam and an x-ray. But again, if you're doing this in a controlled situation, usually the x-rays and the medical exams happen when the treatment is not in place, kind of more in the natural environment. I'm going to talk about bait items. Sometimes we can't include the items, like let's say it's a rock. It's actually really easy to make something look like a rock. Or let's say a paperclip. We can't allow paperclips if they only go after metal objects. So we need to determine, can we include the items that they normally engage in pica with, or are we going to have to come up with items that are substitutable that are safe? And then, you know, you're going to replicate the material. I'll talk about that. That's really fun. And then I mentioned before, if it's not possible to, you're kind of in two camps. One, have a controlled amount of the substance that they normally ingest, or that's unsafe, and then you're going to come up with substitutable items. Here are some common items that I have used in the past. Some of these are items that they already engage with in pica. So you'll notice birthday candles, pieces of wax, and crayons are common culprits for pica anyway. But these are on, at least from my experience with medical consultation, these are definitely more on the safe side. But again, don't take my word for it. Collaborate with a medical professional because they may have individual things that make it not possible. Also, you might want to look at allergies. So you'll notice like the papers, like the different types of papers. Those are papers that are made out of food, but if the individual has any kind of food sensitivities or allergies, you want to stay away, obviously, from those items. A couple of things that you might want to know about that are really helpful. Okay, so I've had to spend a lot of time figuring out how to make PICA items out of these different bait items. So if they go after metal, they actually have, like in catering company, like you'll see it in a baking aisle, cake decorating, they'll have these little, they're delicious, those little silver and gold sugars. And those are, you know, those really have metal, so that's legit. But then you also have edible spray-on or painting, like silver. So again, these are safe to consume. They're used in the cake or in, like in cake decorating. But they make things look like they're metal. So I've used like really like the thinnest pretzels that I can find that are unsalted, and I'll spray them down, and they kind of look like metal objects that you might find. It's not perfect, but I'd rather them eat a pretzel than, you know, they can't eat the metal. So that's the next best thing that we can get. Also, if they engage with liquids, you could do a couple of things. I only put this one. Have any of you heard of thicket? If any of you've worked in feeding, or you probably have heard of this, this is just a powder that you can use. It's really interesting to work with. It's weird, but you stick it in water or any other kind of liquid, and it actually like it's almost like cornstarch, where it kind of increases the consistency and it makes it kind of wobbly. So you can add just a little bit to water and kind of increase the viscosity or decrease the viscosity. That's right, and make it a slightly thicker, so that, because have any of you, you've probably felt bleach on your hands. It's it kind of reminds me of what water is, like alkalized water or like water that's been in cucumber. It's like softer than just water that comes out of the tap. It's also slightly thicker. So you might use a little bit of blue food coloring, put it in the bottle that it looks like, have it with water. You can also find, if it's like a color thing and you don't have the exact color, you can try unsweetened Kool-Aid or other, but you gotta go with the unsweetened kind. But you can also use that to affect the color and things like that if you can't get it with a food coloring. But there are these different items that are used in mostly in with food products that can actually assist you with making PICA items, and usually it's really easy to get volunteers to make it. Doing things like if you can find a food coating that isn't metallic, you could use beans and kind of create a surface that looks like a rock. That's another thing that has been done in the past, and also just like different noodles, like spaghetti noodles sprayed with the metal also look like metal objects, and you can find all of those different. You can go into Little Italy or like around commercial area and find some really cool looking some cool looking noodles and probably get some good PICA items. That was probably one of my more favorite jobs at my work. It was certainly easier than running FAs on functional analysis with aggressive behavior. Certainly more of a preferred activity. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about treatment, and I'm going to give some general suggestions, and I'm going to show you some research examples. And when I show you the research examples, a lot of it is much of it is assessing it, and then for the purpose of treatment development. So we'll still talk about assessment. Okay, here. So now I'm gonna tell you about that case that I think is quite interesting. First, let me show you, they did a functional analysis, and here they did kind of, I guess, what you might consider to be more old school, where they did the full functional analysis as indicated by Iwata and his colleagues in 1982, 1994. So here, let me just point out something to you. The sessions are displayed along the x-axis, and then PICA per minute is displayed along the y. Here in the toy play, that's the control condition. Do we want the control condition here? And then like, look, it's the highest. Wow. It's really high. So what that means is, one, the toy play doesn't compete with PICA, that's for sure. And also, it seems to be high regardless of what's going on. There's certainly some variability, but kind of regardless of those situations, when PICA items are available, they're, you know, Mary was engaging in PICA. Same goes for Brandy. With the exception of, this is kind of interesting, and this is one of the reasons why I think functional analysis can be so useful. So here, this is the escape condition, where the experimenter is doing work with the individual, and providing, based on PICA, escape for problem behavior, for the PICA. However, even when they provide escape, generally you see low levels of PICA. So that means that when they're engaged in work tasks, they're going to be less likely to engage in PICA. So that, again, might be a temporary fix. It's certainly a lot more effective than the control condition, the toy play. So make them do work. Don't give them toys. We're not sure yet what's going on with this one. This is the case that I think is interesting, Mr. Tad. So here, we get, this is the attention condition. And then everything else is pretty low. You get a little bit of a blip here that's unsurprising, but then it all goes down to near zero levels of behavior. So what this means is that Tad is engaging in PICA to get attention. And that's unusual, because usually it's at least maintained in part by automatic reinforcement. Now this functional analysis didn't show that. So let me go into his, they did a kind of a more substantive evaluation of the role of attention and the role of automatic reinforcement. So in this, the graphs are set up identically. They're pretty much all set up like this, where time is along the X and then PICA per minute is along the Y. Now, you can look here in the attention baseline. This is engaging in five PICA behaviors per minute. That's a lot. Again, these are safe items that have been deemed appropriate, but still, that is quite a bit of PICA. So in the attention baseline, what's happening is every time the individual engages in PICA, the experimenter pays attention to them. And for this particular individual, the parents were very likely to reprimand. So one of the things, I'm just as a side note, you want to watch out when you're assessing attention is that you want to look at how people respond to it. So usually when somebody hits you, are you going to say, "Aw, don't do that, you poor sweetie, like, don't hit me." No, usually the response is, "Stop doing that, don't do it, it's not okay to hit me," and it's usually a firmer tone. Now, if somebody bangs their head really forcefully on the wall and they're engaging in self-injurious behavior, it's usually reverse, where the parent is going to be more caregiving, like, "Oh my goodness, don't hurt you know, I don't want you to hurt, baby doesn't hurt his head," or, you know, like those kinds of statements. It's going to be a more nurturing tone compared to aggression. So what we do want to look at is the quality of the attention that's being provided for PICA. So it might be like, "Oh honey, don't eat that paperclip, don't eat it, don't eat it, don't eat it," or it might be like, "Stop doing that, it's not okay for you to do it." And so then when you're assessing attention, you want to be sure to capture the quality. So sometimes you can get that through direct observation, or better yet, you can just ask them, "So what does it look like when they engage in PICA? What do you do? Like, let's pretend, okay, I'm the kid." And then you see kind of what they do. That's probably a cheaper solution than trying to go in and to observe how the person responds. So they did this in the attention baseline, lots of behavior. Then they went into this condition where they just spent the non-contingent attention. They paid attention to him the whole time, and lo and behold, we hardly ever get any behavior. And then they recapture high levels of behavior when they start paying attention to PICA again. And then they go with this final treatment evaluation, and things are going well, but then you get this variability, and there's like still some things going on there. And so this design here is, they're just testing one function, and it's a reversal design. So you're going from one phase to a next. I recommended a pairwise, but you can also do a reversal design. But then this condition right here is something different entirely. Does anybody have an idea of why they did this?
See what in the absence of an adult or another person, are they still going to engage in the behavior?
Why do you think they did that, though?
Because they wanted to see if it is caused by the attention seeking or not.
Right, and the reason why is they're kind of responding to this. Yeah. So, you know, this is still one behavior or like a couple of behaviors in a session. That's not acceptable for PICA. We need to get it down to zero levels or really near zero, like maybe where you might see one instance of behavior every once in a while. It depends on the severity of the behavior. If they're eating grass, it might be a little bit more acceptable to have something like this. But still, this is not ideal. This is a 5-minute session, and you see every 5 minutes they're engaging in PICA. That's still a lot of behavior. And this is an intensive treatment where they're just paying attention to them the whole time. So this isn't really a sustainable intervention, and this variability in behavior is not really, certainly awesome, good results, but like this isn't where we want to be at. We need to get better than that. So what they did is they did it in a lone condition where they just did an extended one. And let me show you why. You do see a little blip in the behavior here. There is some behavior in that same condition. That's that no interaction condition, but then it goes down. But it might be that, hey, you know, when you spend the whole time giving them demands, that reduces the value of engaging in PICA when you're alone. So just switching between these different conditions might have reduced the likelihood that you'd even see behavior in the alone, and that's why they go to this extended alone, so that they can see, is it persisting? And it does. And it's not as high as when they pay attention to it here, but it's still high nonetheless, and this is socially unacceptable. We can't allow kids to engage in that much PICA, and so that helps. So the initial functional analysis revealed attention, and they worked on that, and things were looking good, but not, and so there was like, are we missing the automatic function? Did we miss it in the FA because of the way that we did the FA? Maybe. So then they tested it, and then they found out. So this is where we need to be flexible and continue to be open-minded about what might be maintaining behavior, because our assumption or even some initial results might not give us the entire picture. So then I'm going to show you a graph that's got a whole lot going on, but I'm going to explain it in a way that makes sense to you and that you'll actually be able to interpret. So what they did is, for all three individuals, the PICA behavior was maintained in part by automatic reinforcement. For Tad here was also maintained by attention. That was going to be addressed in another component of the intervention. But what they wanted to do was find out, they looked at the PICA items and they identified a group of matched stimuli and unmatched stimuli. So, for example, let's say that the PICA was chewing sticks. Then they might look at chewing dried banana chips, because those are kind of matched. They have some, they share some similar properties. They're crunchy, they go in your mouth. They certainly have different flavors, but it's matched in the sense that it shares some physical properties. An example of an unmatched stimulus would be a toy. They're not putting it in their mouth, hopefully. And it's not matched to the stimulation that's hypothesized to be affecting PICA. So what they did, and this is what's called a competing items assessment, and this is super useful and something that I would highly recommend that you do when you're starting off with PICA. This is an indicated assessment that also leads to treatment. So what they did is the matched are the black bars. The unmatched are these gray bars. And then, like these bars here that have the squiggly lines. And then the PICA is the, this is the gray, which is here. This is unmatched. And then the PICA is this open with the squiggly lines. So what they want to find are items, regardless if it's matched or unmatched, what they want to find are items where they're interacting with the item a bunch. That's what's shown on this y-axis, the percentage of time that they're interacting with the matched item. So if you give them banana chips, what percentage of the time are they eating the banana chips? And what's happening with PICA? So for this individual, they looked at PICA per minute because it was a discrete behavior. But for these individuals, they looked at duration of PICA because it was like, you know, putting the material in your mouth and kind of chewing on it. It was more of a durational behavior. So they're looking at what you want to identify is items where there's a high level of engagement and low levels of PICA. because that is what would compete with PICA. So if I give you banana chips and you also have PICA items available, are you eating the PICA, or are you eating the PICA items and the banana chips don't mean anything? Or are you, or are they engaging with the banana chips and rarely eating the PICA items? You want to find items that they're interacting with and engaging with most of the time and that they're not engaging in PICA with. Some items kind of facilitate, and I know that you both experienced this with your theses, but you might find that if you give them certain items, it facilitates it. Sometimes we see this with stereotypy, where you give them a string and they engage in body rocking and hand flopping and jumping down, up and down, and when you give them a string, now they're doing it actually even more and the string's going along with it. Sometimes items don't compete, they actually facilitate the behavior, but sometimes you can find items that actually reduce the likelihood of seeing the behavior. So here, if you want to be sent the PDF, what you'll look for in this article are these items that are indicated by the asterisks. So these are items that are associated with high levels of engagement. You get a whole bunch of engagement here. 95% of the time, they are eating graham crackers. Now, we'll get into the functionality of that. We can only do that for so long. But then you also, with the squiggly lines, see hardly any instances of of PICA. So that's a pretty good item. In contrast, when you give them access to the massager, low level of interaction right here, but high levels of PICA. So these are the items. These items that are indicated by the asterisks are the ones that are kind of reasonable to include and consider for treatment. You'll notice that some of the items that they identified are actually the unmatched stimuli. You'll notice in the gray bars, these are unmatched, but a lot of them are matched stimuli that seem to, their items that go in the mouth are usually food items. Common ones are rice cakes and popcorn and things like that are usually fairly effective. Obviously, it's going to depend on the individual, but they looked at things like, I'll just give you some examples since you can't read it, banana chips, dried coconut, access to a mirror. That's an example of an unmatched stimuli. Beef jerky. I find that with PICA items, especially when you're worried about calorie content, when you're looking at the items to include in the competing items assessment, try to find low calorie items that take a long time to eat. That's ideal. And so you also need to worry about things like the amount of salt. So beef jerky has a lot of salt in it. So there are certainly going to be some considerations, but I'd certainly rather somebody eating beef jerky than swallowing bleach. That's, now I'm kind of dramatizing the comparison, but I think you understand the point. Now, you won't notice this on the graph, but here for Tad, and this is the individual that had attention and automatically reinforced PICA, banana chips was one of the best. It produced 100% item engagement, eating the banana chips, no instances of PICA, but you'll notice that there's no asterisk there. And this is kind of interesting. So let me tell you a little bit. I haven't told you what Tad's PICA behavior is, and this is why it's one of my favorite articles in JAVA, just because it is incredibly unusual, and they did a lot of interesting analyses. But this wasn't the exclusive PICA behavior, but I'll give you an example. He was reported, and this is in the article, that he would go into the backyard and try to eat dead squirrels in the backyard. So
dead squirrels can one find?
What?
How many dead squirrels are in
the backyard? I am unsure. Yeah, maybe it was like a squirrel death zone in the back, and that just happened to be where they all kind of, but it had happened. It wasn't that, it was a common PICA, but that is a very intensely dangerous behavior. We can't have people eating dead wild animals. It's just unsafe and dangerous. But the reason why banana chips, and this is why I think it's really interesting and it's very important to collaborate with caregivers, and I say this in a laughing matter, but it is really serious, is that they found banana chips to be unacceptable. They did not want to include banana chips regardless of how good the intervention was. Because they considered it to be messy. And in my mind, I'm thinking, what's messier, banana chips or eating dead squirrels? And like trying to take a dead squirrel out of a kid's hand that's trying to eat it. To me, the choice seems clear, but we could be flexible because there's like a lot of other good items that came out on this assessment. We don't need banana chips. And so if they're unwilling to do it, no point in adding that in. And there are also some other good ones. If you end up with less awesome results, like you only get two asterisks, then it might be possible, it's probably a conversation that needs to be had about balancing out the treatment effect and talking about the danger of the behavior. But if you have a whole bunch of items that are reasonable, just go with those items, and then it becomes like a non-issue. People can live a life without eating banana chips. It is a completely tolerable event, and that is, and we know if banana chips are considered messy, they're not going to implement the treatment. And because they're going to be avoiding the mess and doing all that stuff, and that's not what we want. And so luckily they had a whole bunch of items. But that is the first time that I've ever seen in an article where they're talking about something like a behavior like that. And so it always stood out to me in graduate school. When I read this article for the first time, it stood out to me. And I think in my computer it's called, the article is saved as squirrel pica, because when I want to find that article, I look it up by squirrel, because I don't have any other files with that name in it, and it's very easy for me to find it.
Laura, there's a couple of unmatched items that, especially, particularly for Todd, goes to almost zero. Like music, bubbles, and sometimes parents, because I'm thinking of parents that don't want edibles. So maybe you can use some of those alternatives.
Yes, and so you bring up a good point. And so this whole banana chip thing could have been avoided by giving the parents this list and saying, or a more comprehensive list, which ones are you good with? Like, which ones are you willing to include in your environment? And then those are the ones that you assess. The good news is that there are more. These are just the ones that they picked for their analysis. They wanted three unmatched and three matched. So that's what they got with this six right here. But clinically speaking, there are a whole bunch of other items. And so what I would do is create a list of items that compete and then find out ways to incorporate them and what might be reasonable. So if you have unmatched stimuli, like different toys, that's probably a more reasonable treatment to do before mealtime, because the parents are not going to want to give their kid a whole bunch of raisins before they sit down for the meal, because what's going to happen? They're not going to eat. They're going to be full of other stuff. They're going to probably run away from the table. And dinner is not going to be the enjoyable event that it should be. And we don't want our interventions to affect and throw a wrench into that family routine. So it is a good idea to have unmatched stimuli that are non-food items, so that you can have a balance and some choice around those items. Okay, so here is the subsequent treatment evaluation that they did. And I'm just going to, I'll walk you through this middle one, Brandy, just for the sake of time. Again, she had behavior that was exclusively maintained by automatic reinforcement. They do this alone baseline, and they get high levels of behavior. Then they go into a phase where they provide non-contingent access to matched and unmatched, either matched stimuli or unmatched stimuli, and then they look at the effect on behavior. So this, we're just looking at PICA here. So when in the second phase right here, when the individual has access to matched and unmatched stimuli, we don't see any PICA. This is fantastic. So then we just want to make sure that the treatment works and that there's not something else going on here that resulted in the decrease in behavior. Like, for example, if they gave them a medicine that reduces behavior in general, not just PICA, but it reduces all behavior. They have medicines like that. That's a reason why you might get that effect. So this is good and we're excited, but we're not making the conclusion that this treatment is effective. Then we go back to the alone baseline and we see, oh, you know what? High levels of behavior, it was probably not something else. It was probably the treatment that resulted in a reduction. Here's where it gets interesting. They redo the matched and unmatched stimuli evaluation, and this open squares, can anybody guess what, if it's matched or unmatched?
Unmatched.
Yeah, exactly, unmatched. So over time, those items became less effective at competing. So that's why it's always important when we do this is not to just assess and say, oh, these items are great, let's just do this, and never critically evaluate how it's going. So some of those items might become less effective over time, and you might need to reassess some other items. But they found that for this particular individual, probably sticking with matched stimuli is probably going to work pretty well. And I'm going to move on so that we can talk about another study, but I think that one was kind of an interesting case. I know that I moved around the slides a little bit, so thank you. All of the slides are in there. The information is in there, but it is moved around just a bit. Before I go to the next slide, let me just show you one other quick thing about this particular slide. What they did is they noticed that they kind of looked at the themes. So let's just take Tad, for example. These, a lot of the ones that came out really high that were matched were really crunchy items like banana chips, coconut chips, bagel chips. Raisins are an exception. That one's a softer food. But they kind of saw that, is this a texture thing or is it maybe a flavor thing? What seems to be the component of the items that seem to be having an impact on the pica? And you might wonder, like, oh, why would you do that? You don't really need it. But I'll show you the results and why it will be important for future treatment provision. So here what they did is they wanted to separate out the effects of flavor versus texture for items that compete with pica. So again, these are the items, like the food items that have been shown to be effective at competing with pica. Some of them I think were like a strawberry flavored rice cake. So that would be like an example of something that's crunchy and that's flavored with strawberry versus something that is flavored with strawberry but that is not crunchy and that's soft would be like strawberry flavored gelatin. So basically they looked at, and you'll see it here, plain gelatin, strawberry gelatin, plain rice cakes, and I thought they had the strawberry rice cakes. The strawberry rice cake. So what they kind of wanted to know is it the flavor, is it the strawberry flavor? Because that'll lead you down a path of finding everything that's strawberry and seeing if it will affect pica. But if it's actually the crunch and has nothing to do with the strawberry flavor, then you kind of want to go down the path of crunchy foods, because again, we can't count on the fact that rice cakes will always compete with pica. We want to be exploratory and try to find other items that are kind of like that that will compete, because you know the effectiveness may wear off. We want to rotate those items and not just always give them one particular item. And so here what they find is that overall with the gelatin, you're seeing more levels of pica compared to the two different rice cakes. So this suggests that it's probably the crunchy factor and not necessarily the flavor factor. And again, this is getting down into real like minutia, but it is really important, because if we take the results from the competing items assessment, the assumption might be, oh, strawberry things really compete, and then you're getting into all this strawberry business when really it's about the crunch, and you can be using things like carrot sticks and other healthy items to compete with So we don't want to rule out items based on assumptions, and we don't want to retain items based on assumptions. So I'm not necessarily recommending that you go to this level to do this in clinical practice, but I think this highlights that we may get some results, but we need to constantly ask questions, particularly around automatic reinforcement, because it isn't as easy to identify the reinforcing properties. I can't just say to somebody, why do you engage in pica? Do you like it because of the way that it makes your mouth feel? Is it because it's crunchy? Is it because of the throat sensation? We usually cannot, we don't have access to our clients in that way oftentimes, and so we need to do some analysis to figure it out. And then with Brandy, they did something similar. They didn't go into much major detail. What they did is they just wanted to do the hard and the soft comparison. If I had to guess, I'd say these data were collected first, and they did the flavor and the texture comparison and found the texture, and then maybe they just did the texture here. That's an assumption. But still, nonetheless, for both of these individuals, the hard items competed much more than the soft items. I think it'd be really interesting to do something like this where you're looking at the type of pica item versus what will function as a competing item. So if they're drinking household cleaners, then it might be certain liquids that might compete, or it might be something soft like tofu, or something like a soft tofu or something like that. So it might be kind of, I think future research should probably take a look at the nature of the pica item and then actually some of these other variables. So I've described some research, but this research is limited in that behavior still persisted even with these intensive interventions in place. A lot of times they're not addressing generalization of the behavior. They're conducting these sessions in a very controlled environment. Those studies are necessary, but in the work that we do out in the field, we need to ensure that these treatments are generalized and they're implemented in meaningful environments, and we need to make sure that the behavior is happening at a level that is sustainable and that's safe and that's not life-threatening. Some goals to address any medical causes, first and foremost, to identify those, and then to develop a comprehensive intervention that will address the both the medical and the behavioral causes. With this particular behavior, it's really important to implement intervention all of the time. Now, that doesn't necessarily involve paying attention to the person the whole time. There are other strategies that are used, but in general, the mindset needs to be we're engaging in behaviors that are going to reduce the likelihood of PICA happening. So there are different groups of interventions. There are antecedent-based interventions, and then there are consequence interventions. So we can do things that will make PICA, give them less of an opportunity to engage in PICA, reduce the likelihood that they'll do it at all, and then if it does happen, how do we respond to it in the moment? These are some data, like some overall data, and I just want to show you, this is the function of PICA right here, and for the most part, we see out of the number of studies that they looked at, 7 of the cases were maintained by automatic reinforcement, whereas only 1 was maintained by attention. And then you'll look at, what are the treatments that were effective? Now, they considered effective to be an 80% reduction. I think in clinical practice, we're looking for more, like for this particular behavior, we're ideally looking for 100%. Again, that's an artifact of the studies and a criticism, which is they're still engaging in some behavior. Clinically, I'd be looking at like 98% reduction. 95 to 100 is probably the goal I'd be setting as the initial goal and then kind of seeing. But then you kind of look, they look at behavior analytic treatments and other treatments, and then they look at, here's an effective treatment at 80% reduction, here's an effective treatment at 90% reduction, which is really interesting. So they separated out the data. So reinforcement only was not very effective for all of the cases. So if you're reinforcing the absence of PICA, so every time they don't do it for 10 seconds, you're providing a reinforcer, that's not terribly effective at occasioning an 80% reduction. Response reduction only, so only focusing on the consequence side of it and how you're going to respond to behavior, again, 8 out of the 26 cases produced an 80% reduction. The most effective here, and also with the case with the 90% reduction, is reinforcement in conjunction with some kind of response reduction. So that's why I'm going to review the antecedent and consequence-based procedures, because typically when you're dealing with this behavior, you're going to have both of those, you're definitely going to have both of those components in place. We want to reduce the likelihood that they have access to those PICA items, and then when it happens, we want to implement an intervention that's going to reduce the likelihood of them doing it again. One important piece to addressing PICA is family education. So you can imagine the first video I showed you, all of those items were fair game. So things like toothpaste and soap and all of these other things that are normally, I don't know about you all, but I don't lock those items up. Those are fair game. If people are in my environment, they can see them and interact with them. But for these families, some more vigilance needs to happen around those items. So having locked medicine cabinets with those items in it, having locks on cabinets that store unsafe materials and things like that. Also educating families. So you know, the parents might do a really good job of keeping that environment clean from PICA items, but when they go to grandma and grandpa's house, they've got all like the antiques and all this stuff going on. So you kind of need to make sure that all of those environments, that there's just any kind of dangerous items are removed from the environment and stored in an area that is safer. And then sometimes you'll find that some family homes are a little bit, like they have more stuff going on. It's, you know, there's things on the floor. And it becomes very difficult to detect whether or not they're engaging in PICA. So if they eat Legos, but there's Legos everywhere, it's really difficult to determine whether or not they've eaten Legos. And then you see them, you know, and you're like, did you just eat 2 pounds of Legos, or are you hungry? And then it becomes a guessing game, and it's going to produce more emergency room visits and all of this other burden on the families that could be very intense. So instead of doing that, kind of teaching them how to keep that environment a little bit more clean so that you can, and showing them the benefit of that, that they can actually identify when PICA happens more likely, and then they can respond to it medically if that's needed. One thing I'll mention, I showed you the picture of the client with the safety pin sticking out of his throat. So he, or in his throat, there was a lot of family education that needed to happen, and so they actually sent a therapist to their home. They traveled actually extraordinary distances to get the assessment and treatment for the kids' PICA because it was life-threatening. Then there was a bit of a setback, and the therapist on the case asked the family about this, and it was Christmas time, and he eats metal objects. You know where I'm going with this. They put up the tree with all the ornaments, and at one point they took paper clips, which are very much a PICA item for him, and they stuck jujubes on the ends of them and used it as a decoration. So it's like, you not only get your favorite PICA item, but you also get an edible item. Now, they were just getting ready for their family holiday. You know, they're not trying to increase the likelihood that their kid is going to eat metal objects, but it's kind of one of those reframing of, or how do you still celebrate in a way that also doesn't put them at risk? So looking at the nature of the like ornaments and like you can come up with different ornaments. He went after metal, so you know, all those ornaments had those little metal hooks, but you can find ornaments that don't have those or have, you know, pieces of string he didn't go after. So there's ways that they can still do what they normally do, but it needs to be adjusted a little bit. So now I'm going to go into some of the antecedent strategies that are used to reduce the likelihood that the individual is going to engage in PICA. So one way to do it is environmental enrichment, and that sounds maybe counterintuitive because I just mentioned that you need to clean up the environment, and now I'm saying add items back in. But add items back in that are not going to facilitate PICA. It might be something like if you know that demands from the functional analysis, if you know demands compete with PICA, or the family's report or the teacher reports, you know, when we do work, I never see them go after PICA items. It only happens at recess when there's not a whole lot going on. Then that might give you an idea of interspersing work tasks, maybe doing some activities with toys and things like that might help to reduce the likelihood of that PICA happening. And usually when you kind of see two things, one, like kind of two extremes, one where the family home, there's PICA items galore and they're kind of all over the place, but then there are the complete other end of the spectrum, which is there's nothing in the environment, there aren't any toys, there's not any, not only are there not PICA items, but there are also not just items to engage with. So there needs to be something in the middle where there aren't PICA items available, but there are all these the environment isn't enriched in a way that produces more engagement with that environment. It's not the same thing as a sensory room, and I won't go into the details or the distinction, but I'm not saying that, oh, when they're engaging in PICA, put them in a sensory room. I'm saying that regardless of whether behavior is happening or not, we want to enrich the environment so that they have things that they can interact with. This may or may not be effective. I think, again, doing a competing items assessment and getting some more information might help you to determine whether or not this is something to do. Other things, so Courtney, you talked about your client that engaged in poop eating or coprophagia. Okay, oh, not your client, your son. And this happens all the time. I'm sure without us remembering it, some of us might have done that too when we were kids. But they have shown with individuals that if you give them access to spicy food, that might reduce the likelihood of coprophagia, which I think is really interesting because I anticipate that the item that they're ingesting might be spicier as a result of the food that they're eating. But then how do you get, if that is a kind of aversive, then how do you get them to eat the spicy food in the first place? But I do think that that's kind of interesting, and if the family uses spice in their food and it's not like an issue with the GI, I think it would be a thing to consider. It's just another way to enrich the environment. So you can kind of find really low calorie, highly spiced snacks and crunchy items and things like that you might consider. And then there are some other options. Now this is just kind of, these things are in the environment and present and available, but kind of the next level that requires a little bit more effort is non-contingent reinforcement. This might happen on a continuous schedule all the time, or it might happen on a time-based schedule where it's every 30 seconds, every minute, every 5 minutes, some reinforcers are delivered. And it's a preventative strategy that helps to reduce the likelihood. So let's say that we know that popcorn competes with PICA, but we don't want to just give them a tub of popcorn at the beginning of the day and say, okay, here's your, you know, bag of popcorn, you'll just carry it around with you and eat it. Like that's not reasonable, right? And so it might be something where at first you demonstrate, okay, when they have non-contingent access to popcorn, we're not seeing pica. And then it might be, okay, if we give them a popcorn kernel every 15 seconds, are we still seeing low levels of behavior? And maybe we just give them a popcorn snack of a couple of kernels every 5 minutes. And so we're kind of just making that schedule a little bit leaner over time so that people in the environment can do it. It's reasonable, but it's also associated with low levels of behavior. I mentioned a little bit of this. You do want to consider some things when you're setting up NCR. For the behavior analysts out there, this is going to seem like a review, but you do want to look at, I mentioned density, so are we doing it all the time, or are we just giving them reinforcers on a time-based schedule every once in a while? Likely that you'll start off with something very dense, and then you'll thin the schedule to something that is maintainable in the natural environment. You also want to think about stimulus magnitude. So do you want to give them one popcorn kernel, or do you need to give them three popcorn kernels? That's just kind of an example. And then, you know, I mentioned some things about schedule thinning, which is actually similar to the first point. I've already talked to you about the competing items assessment, so I'm not going to go into too much detail about that. But what you would do is probably identify some items that are reasonable and acceptable to the family, and then go in and do a preference assessment of all of those items. And then what you would do is set up a situation, these different sessions where maybe they're 5 minutes long, and you bait the item, the room with PICA items, and you also have the competing items that may function as, so you might identify two or three items in the preference assessment that are reinforcing, and then you're going to give them access to those items during the competing items assessment and look at its effect on PICA. So again, you want high levels of engagement with the safe item and low levels of PICA. Another one that is reasonable, but again, is something that can't be used as the end-all be-all because it requires a lot of kind of hovering and watching over and kind of looming. And again, this might be something that needs to happen, but it's not sustainable to say something like, okay, well, you'll just not let them do it because when you see them do it, you'll just block that from happening. That's probably, you know, that might be something that's used in conjunction with some interventions, but I just want to be clear that we shouldn't use response blocking as the only option. It is a consequence-based strategy, but it is very reasonable to block instances of PICA, particularly if we're talking about items that are going to result in injury. So, one thing to keep in mind with PICA is that sometimes there are some reliable precursors. So let's say that they don't normally engage in hand mouthing or mouthing or anything like that. And you'll notice when, I'll just do this because it's my own, you'll notice that when, before they actually go to eat the item, they'll do this like lip rubbing thing, or they'll just, you know, do like this and then they eat it. You want to block the precursor and don't wait for the actual PICA, because once it passes the plane of the mouth, it's very difficult to block the behavior, and we want to prevent it. So don't just wait for the PICA to happen, like as defined, like actually swallowing the item, because then we can't retrieve it and block it. But if there are some precursors that happen, so they're engaging with the item particularly, or if they only go after metal objects and they go to pick it up, That's when you want to intervene with response blocking, not when they've already engaged in the more severe behavior. Sometimes there's not any kind of precursor. It might be just like, there's one and it's really quick. And then at that point, you want to block that. You also want to use the least intrusive form of blocking. So, and this will really be determined how they respond to blocking, because I mentioned you want to check that out. So if they're more likely to engage in more like aggression and things like that, that's probably going to be something that has to be addressed in a different way that is beyond the conversation today. But it might be as easy as you don't even have to touch them, and that you just kind of hold your hand right here, and then when the arm goes to put the item in the mouth, you've blocked it, rather than, that's a lot less intrusive because you're not actually laying your hands on them, versus they're midway into the PICA and now you're having to physically guide their hand out of their mouth. That's a more intrusive form of blocking, and that's why I recommend looking for those precursors, because usually it's really easy to block like that or to prevent it. So if they're going after the sole paperclip in the room, I can just stand between them, the two item or the person and the item, and kind of block it in that way. One of the limitations of blocking is that it doesn't, one, teach any skills, and also it requires somebody to be paying attention all of the time. And this is unreasonable in environments in the community and in schools and at homes and things like that. So again, if we see it, we want to block it, but it shouldn't be the go-to end-all be-all intervention. We can also reinforce incompatible behavior. So you know, we can think of things that they might do with their hands or things that they might do with their mouth that prevent the development or that prevent the instance of PICA. So it might be something like certain kinds of toy play. If they're interested, that would be an example of an incompatible behavior. Again, it still does require that somebody's around to pay attention to that behavior. But again, all of the consequence strategies, those are kind of the limitations of the consequence strategies. But based on the data that I showed you earlier, in order to get reliably an 80 to 90% reduction in behavior, we need to be implementing both antecedent and consequence strategies. That's the most likely thing that's going to reduce behavior. So now we're going to get into empirically derived consequences. And I like to use this term because I think it is, it doesn't bring about some of the thinking that prevents us sometimes from using a very useful strategy that is often needed with a life-threatening behavior like PICA. And what I'm talking about with empirically derived consequences is the use of punishment to reduce PICA. And this is reasonable to consider when, one, if you have kind of a moderately safe PICA behavior like eating grass or eating dirt, you should start off with a reinforcement-based procedure because it's not life-threatening. There's some amount of that behavior that can happen without producing injury, and that's very reasonable. And then you'll see what happens. So if behavior reduces and things look good, everything's awesome and you're going to continue to do that. But in some cases, that is not sufficient for changing behavior. And so then we're in a situation where we need to look at other interventions. So I'm going to talk to you about a study that I think is helpful. A lot of times when people think of, if they do end up going the route of punishment in conjunction with reinforcement-based strategies and antecedent-based strategies, they might just decide, I'm going to use a certain stimulus, and there's an assumption that that is going to be a punisher because we think it's unpleasant. So I might think squirting lemon into somebody's mouth is aversive. I actually would be like, please give it to me. I love lemon. It tastes so delicious. So punishment's defined by its effects, and what punishes my behavior may not punish your behavior. But if we're talking about a life-threatening behavior, this is a territory where punishment can be considered, especially if its reinforcement is not effective. And I wouldn't wait to demonstrate that a reinforcement-based procedure is ineffective when we're talking about a life-threatening behavior. So let me just show you what they did. And I've implemented this assessment multiple times, and I have some experience with it. So this isn't just the research study. I actually had to do this clinically multiple times. So this was a study that was done by Wayne Fisher, Kathleen Piazza, and some of their other colleagues. And instead of just saying, you know, we're going to implement this one punishment procedure without evaluating it, they actually wanted to look at assessing it. So here they have these different stimuli that might function as a punisher. So I'll just give you like an example. One is contingent demand. So if a person engages in PICA, then it would be fold that piece of paper, stand up, touch your toes, maybe not touch your toes, that's contingent exercise, but it would basically be a series of instructions that you would provide where they're engaging in compliance. So you're just like making them do a little bit of work after they engage in, for example, PICA. Another example is contingent exercise. So this was contingent on PICA or some other behavior. They would require that the individual engage in physical exercise, like touching your toes. So touch your toes, touch your toes, touch your toes. And then there are other ones like water mist, clean water, and that is sprayed to this part of the mouth is generally aversive. Interestingly, if you they use water sprays to reinforce dolphin behavior at zoos. So again, it gives you a good idea that not everything functions as a punisher. We shouldn't assume it. We all have kind of differences in those things. So then what they did is they looked at avoidance movements and negative vocalization. So what would happen is 30 seconds, there's nothing going on, and then the next 30 seconds, they're going to implement the procedure non-contingently. So let's say it's following instructions. So the next 30 seconds, I'm just gonna say, clap your hands, touch your toes, do this, do that. And so what I'm gonna look at is compliance. Them saying, no, I don't want to, I don't wanna do that. That's an indication that it's probably aversive. But, and that's kind of what we're after, is we're trying to find something that they want to avoid. The other thing that you also want to look at are indices of happiness. So sometimes, like, we'll look at things like a basket hold, which is a particular procedure that's used to prevent somebody from engaging in, for example, PICA. I've had clients where when it's time to do the procedure, they do. I'm ready. That's not the procedure we want to use. And we might assume, you know, oh, you put somebody in a basket hold, that's going to be aversive. But I know plenty of kids that have behavior that's maintained by physical attention. Plenty of most typically developing people's, some behavior in part is motivated by physical attention. So what they did is they looked at avoidance behavior minus indices of happiness and like trying to get into the procedure, and we would subtract them. So all the like negative aversive things minus all the like happiness smiles and things like that to come up with an avoidance index. And so here, these are considered, the high ones are considered high avoidance. So this one was facial screen, which is you have to do it in a very specific way. You have to be trained to do it, but you put your hand over the child's face and prevent them from getting visual access. The reason why you need to be trained to do it and have appropriate supervision is because the eyes are a very delicate place. So the way you do it is you actually hold the place that's the contact is right above. It's actually right here. And there's actually no contact between the hand and the eyes, because you don't want to be pressing up against somebody's eyes. That's unsafe and that's not okay. So again, there are ways, specific ways that these procedures are implemented, and it's highly supervised so that we're doing it the right way. So these are the ones that are likely to function as punishers. Interestingly, all three of them came out as the facial screen. But then these are low, like the water mist. They were probably, maybe they had some chips before the session. And then like, yeah, the water mist was generally low for all of these individuals. So here's what they did. Again, this is just more avoidance movements. These are the results from AVAs. So they did a baseline with PICA where they just, it was an alone baseline. There were PICA items there that were unsurprised, lots of behavior. Then they evaluated the facial screen contingent demands, which is like touch your, like clap your hands, those kinds of things. And then hands down, which is just somebody walking behind the person and then just gently with minimal force putting their hands down. And then they kind of rotated between those. And that's something that if we know that there are several items that might function as punishers, we want to rotate between them, because that will produce a more impactful and better result. And then we see, again, definitely reductions in behavior. It's still 2 per minute, so clinically we might question it, but certainly definitely a reduction. And so these data suggest that, you know, implementing this particular, these series of procedures resulted in a reduction in PICA. Let me go over some considerations, and I definitely want to make sure that we get to this. When we're considering punishment, we need to make sure that we're using it in conjunction with reinforcement-based procedures, because we want to give them ways to interact more meaningfully with their environment. We want to give them like opportunities to engage and get access to reinforcers for engaging in the behaviors that we want to see instead of PICA. So we don't want to just get rid of PICA. We want to replace it with things that are going to be meaningful and important for them. We also want to identify those punishment procedures empirically instead of just relying on anecdotal report or an assumption about whether or not something is aversive. And then also we need to clearly monitor the effects of the intervention. So a lot of times if you're thinking, okay, we're going to use water mist to punish PICA in conjunction with all these other elements that we have in place, some people might think, ooh, you know, I don't want to do that. I don't, you know, that's not something that I feel comfortable doing. And so punishment's defined by its effects. So usually when you're implementing punishment, you're only going to be doing that a couple of times, because you're only doing it when they're engaging in problem behavior. And problem behavior should reduce to near zero levels pretty rapidly after you implement punishment. If it's not, it means you're not doing punishment. So you're not going to continue to put water in their face if they're, you know, staring at you and eating the pica items at the same time, you're going to stop doing that because you're not even doing punishment anyway. So we need to be, when we're doing punishment-based procedures and when we're also talking about pica, which is a life-threatening behavior, that case needs to be closely monitored. Daily updates, if not having somebody there present to make decisions that's trained. We also need to make sure that people are safe, and that's why it's important to seek out medical collaboration. That's important when you're baiting the room. You know exactly, I've got 40 spaghetti fake metal items, I've got 20 bean rocks, and I've got 5 crayons. And then you know at the end of the assessment exactly what they've eaten, and that kind of helps with safety assurance. Really punishment should be considered when the behavior is sufficiently severe. So if you're talking about grass eating and you can address that with a reinforcement-based procedure, there is no reason to consider this kind of intervention. And then also, just kind of some more practical things, we need to have very clear protocols. Usually I recommend that protocols are never longer than a page. If they're longer than a page, nobody's going to read it, because it's too detailed. So it needs to be written in a way that people can look at, easily consume, and then implement the intervention. And then also that needs to go under peer review, and you need to have informed consent from the family and from the people that are going to be involved in implementing the treatment. So everybody needs to be on board with that. And then even after you've developed the intervention and like what you'd like to do, it's a good idea to consult with other behavior analysts and other professionals to find out, does this seem reasonable? Is this a good idea? Here's the severity of the behavior. Do the benefits outweigh the costs in terms of our intervention choices? Here are some other things to mention. I've mentioned her name quite a bit, but you can actually look at people's their publications on Google Scholar. If you open up Google Scholar, you search a person's name, oftentimes they have a profile. So I would encourage you, if you're interested in learning more about PICA, is to look up the work of Kathleen Piazza, because she's really done the majority of the high quality research in that area. There's also from the Autism Treatment Network, there is a guide for families with PICA, and so there's a link here. And then also it's discussed within the broader context of self-injurious behavior, but Brian Awada has several good resources that are available. And just as a little bit of a plug, because they do have this up and running, and I think it's a really good resource, and it's my alma mater, but Western Michigan University, their new Center for Autism Excellence, has all of these amazing online resources with people like Iser De Leon talking about preference assessments, Greg Hanley talking about functional communication training. They've got all of these experts. Kathleen Piazza talks about feeding intervention, because since she's just anything that passes through the plane of the mouth, she's an expert on it. So she does feeding and PICA, and they've got a variety of pretty in-depth videos. So we're talking about hour and a half, sometimes 2 hour videos on these topics. And he does a good one on self-injury, and he talks a little bit about PICA within the context of that. So that might be another useful resource. If you have subsequent questions, you can feel free to email me, and I'd be happy to talk with you about it. So thank you.